Free and Heavy Load. Owen, I guess the only track most people know from Free is All Right Now.
Well, All Right, Free were actually one of the victims of the industry's sort of stack 'em high, sell 'em cheap, flog them to death over a very brief period. Free had a very, very sharp ascendant. They did the Isle of Wight Festival and, of course, All Right Now, which is the one everyone associates with Free, also from numerous bubblegum adverts or whatever over the years. They'd actually been going for a couple of albums and they sort of struggled on, but the momentum was killed by them being forced back into the record, into the studios very, very soon. Fire and Water came out in June 1970. The next album was out by October, I think, or September. So right. They did the album, it became big, get them in. So they're under rehearsed, under prepared. And Paul Kossoff, of course, had his own demons with a very bad drug habit, which of course ultimately claimed him in 74 75. But they're quite useful to mention them because these are definitely a tipping point. No longer would with these bands, because they were selling records that was unheard of in particularly in America. America took off, and if they're selling in America, they get them on tour in America to start pushing the album. And of course, you've got such a big country there that they would be on tour for years in some cases. So this old get an album out, get a single, milk it to death, get another one, and then they'll be gone. Era was basically coming to an end.
We were talking when that was playing, and you were talking about the change in the fan base, which I hadn't really realised, that, you know, the Beatles, the Stones, they had all these girls running around after them, but the rock bands that were coming in, they were mainly aiming at a male audience.
Well, I'm not sure if aiming's the correct fan. I know that I think they certainly enjoyed their fair share of female attention in certain areas, but no, the media generally, by this period, the Enemy or the news or papers or used to feature the pop acts, the top of the pop acts, and very rarely did rock bands even target this. Led Zeppelin particularly openly disdained singles, and I don't think they ever released one properly from about 69, 70 onwards. But they had the power enough to actually dictate their own terms. Black Sabbath never really, I mean, they had one single with Paranoid, but that was a throwaway track that somehow sort of became, you know, their signature track. But again, they never really replicated that. Deep Purple, of course, were a little bit more commercial. But many of these acts were first and foremost album acts. They had longer tracks that wouldn't fit into the UK radio industry. I mean, also featured in later shows, of course, FM radio in America was a different ballgame because they'd have songs which were 6, 7, 8 minutes long.
Right.
But definitely, as far as what we're discussing today, this was a time when the album became king and the single became secondary, particularly in the rock world. And mainly their audience were males. I mean, even The Who, which is a good time to play a Who track because Won't Get Fooled Again, which came out in 71... So you're right in the middle of this sort of change in the industry.
Yeah.
Is a classic example. I mean, look at the transition from My Generation, a snappy, also prototypical punk track, to Won't Get Forward Again, which in its full version is 8, 9 minutes long. Yeah, this is a prime example with the keyboards and a big epic production of how a legendary heavy rock scene was evolving, and evolving at a very fast rate.
Shotgun!
That's The Who, one of my favourite bands, I've got to admit, with Don't Get Fooled Again from August 1971. And Owen, the bands that we played so far, although I might not have heard the tracks, I certainly know the bands. The next one I can see on our list, I don't really know much about at all.
Well, we've so far focused in on bands which are sort of household names, or at least known to this day. But there were a secondary level of bands in the early 70s, UK-based bands. I'm primarily talking about bands such as Nazareth, Budgie, Wishbone Ash, and Uriah Heep, who were, for a period, looked like they could have been up there with Sabbath, Zeppelin, Purple. And the track I've chosen to play, which is an edited version, we hope, of Uriah Heep's July Morning from 71. I picked because, it's quite tangible that the link between these and the Led Zeppelin and the Deep Purple tracks. You've got a lot of similarities. You've got these great big pyrotechnic vocals, epic song structure. I mean, this thing's 10.5 minutes long. You've got these sort of quasi-classical themes. A lot of these bands very quickly made a lot of money. Now, Uriah Heep, case in point, they were very big for a while, but then they sort of faded. I mean, they're still active now, and Bernie Shaw is lives locally to the Buckinghamshire area. And they are still very, very big in Eastern Europe. They still tour. They're active to this day. And a great band. And this is a fantastic song. And it's July Morning from Uriah Heep from 1971.
Strangest places. It wasn't a stone that I left unturned. Must have tried more than a